was born in a little small town in South Dakota, southeastern part, and lived on a farm, and I went to school there.
You know, growing up on a farm, was it a childhood that had a lot of chores and even did you have to work, that kind of thing? I mean, did you have things you had to do on the farm?
Oh, yes, yes. My dad was always an early riser. And he didn't really let me do too much until I was older. And but I had things to do. I had to help with the milking. I had to help feed the cattle and so forth. And just was there all the time.
Did you have brothers and sisters?
I had one sister, and she was a little bit older than I because there was a middle sister that I was, I don't remember if I was even born then or was just small, and she got caught on fire on a home and burnt and of course passed away, so I never knew her. But my older sister was, let's see, I think 9 years older than I was.
A real gap.
Yeah.
Was it what I would call an outdoor childhood? You know what I mean? Everything outdoors.
Well, let me tell you, for a long time, all facilities were outside. And we had no running water in the house. We had a pump that the cistern held water that my mom used to use only for washing. But we had a very deep well that furnished all the water for the cattle and so forth, and that's what we drank, which was real hard water. And we had lamps, just an ordinary lamp with oil lamps, I guess they were, I remember. And so basically that was my youth all through most, probably middle of high school.
When you're out there on the farm, how big was the school that you went to?
Well, it was not that big. I think our senior class, we graduated, I think there were 14 of us in it. But we all went through, most of them went through from the first grade to the 12th. We did together.
So was it kind of a close-knit community?
Very much so, yeah.
You know, talk a little bit about how the Depression affected your family.
Well, it didn't bother us that much being on the farm because we had our own food. Mother had a huge big garden, and we raised all, we would usually have a pork, a veal maybe, and a beef. My dad would butcher those at the fall. And of course we had no way of keeping them during the summertime, and that's why they did it in the fall, because you could put them outside and they'd freeze. When you're in 24 below zero weather, it doesn't take long to freeze stuff outside. And basically that we did very well, because our grocery bill, I can remember my mother saying, "Oh my, I can't spend this," and maybe she'd spend $1 or $2 a week for groceries, which is mainly staples, you know, flour and stuff. But we raised, mother used to can an awful lot of vegetables, which I didn't care for at all, and fruit. See, we had a big garden with rhubarb all the way around it. And we supplied everybody in our little old town with rhubarb, practically. And got a big kick out of my mother. She was absolutely against drinking, and somebody made the mistake of coming out and getting the rhubarb and said, "That's gonna make wonderful rhubarb wine." of course, she was one up person who would never say anything bad about anybody. She was just a great person. And so she didn't say anything, but she said to my dad, "We're not going to give them anymore." And that's the way it was.
When you think of your parents now, what do you think about?
Well, of course, they're both gone, naturally. Mother was a wonderful, wonderful person, was a very good cook. My dad was stern. My mother wasn't. I'd kind of laugh at her, and she'd wait till Dad comes in. And of course, didn't have to wait too long. But when my dad said something, I knew that was it. No argument. Because he had it was just his way, and that's it. And it was the right way, but he...
Were they good parents?
Excellent, yes. Mm-hmm. Excellent parents. After I graduated from high school in 1938, I was 18 years old, I think. 18. And I spent, didn't feel that I wanted to go to college right then. We had a college, a nice college in the town that was connected with the grade school that I went to. And so I just kind of bummed around and worked on the farm. Then at that time, as the war was brewing in Europe, and rumors was that we eventually were going to get involved, no doubt about it. So the draft was just being mentioned, and I said, I don't want to be, I told my dad I was going to enlist in some service. Oh, don't do that. Wait till be drafted. And I said, excuse me, that I wasn't going to wait because I didn't want to be drafted and be put in the infantry because I didn't want to carry a gun or walk or march, whatever. And I looked like, to me, the Air Force or the Navy was the best service. So I decided that the Air Force was 3 years, Air Corps at that time, and the Navy was 4. So I thought, well, I'll take the least and see what happens. So I enlisted in I started taking the exam and physical exam and the written exam, which most anybody could pass. The middle part of December. And then I enlisted in, and I think it was around the 20th of December.
Of 1930?
1940.
Oh, 1940. Mm-hmm. And so where did you end up then?
Well, I had to go to Sioux Falls for the recruiting office, and then they sent me to St. Paul, Minnesota, to what was known as the reception center. It was called Fort Snelling. And I never had been away from home much further than 80 miles to 100 miles. And so,
was there a sense of homesickness somewhere in there?
No, not really, because I was so glad to get off the farm that I said nothing could be any worse than this. Because of the during the Depression, it was hard times.
And so, where did it go from there?
Well, as I mentioned, I was talking to you about that I was sent to. The reception in Fort Snelling, and I left that morning from the recruiting office, and it was 24 degrees below zero. And the fellow told me to get on the bus and go at the end of the line, and that would be where I'd get off and go to and report to the guardhouse. That was what it was. Well, I got off, went to the guard, nobody around, cold, place was absolutely freezing. And so I waited and waited, and the patrolman finally came by and said what I was doing, waiting. And I said, well, somebody's supposed to pick me up. Okay, he said. So he called the reception center and said that there was a young fellow down there, come and pick him up. And so about an hour later, he came by, and I'm still there, freezing to death. And he said, haven't they picked you up yet? And I said, no, not yet. Then I was beginning to think maybe I'd made a mistake. But they finally came down and picked me up, and it was about noon. I got there probably at 9 o'clock or 8:30 at the latest. So I was there. I got there just the time when they were serving meal, and of course, I was always used to sitting down with the family and having breakfast and dinner and supper, as we called it in those days. And I arrived there, and here's this big area of people just sitting there chomping away, and there were about 10 people to just tables and benches, and like picnic benches. And so I'm sitting there thinking, what am I going to do? So there was a place I sat down. Well, all of a sudden, it's grabbing this, grabbing that, and I thought, oh, wait a minute. And it was just like they were starved to death. So I finally got to eating and finished. So then I reported in. They assigned me to a barracks, all temporary barracks, and said that you'll get your uniform here, and you'll be processed, and you'll be shipped out for training. Well, that was a fiasco, because there was another fellow in the outfit by the name of Dolan. And so they called my name out to go down. I get there, his papers are there. So they said, well, you'll have to go back and come tomorrow. Well, he went back, and my papers were there. So we finally got straightened out, and I was issued a World War I uniform. I had an overcoat that came up above my knees that looked at, like something was cut off. I got leggings, old cavalry knicker thing with wrapped leggings, and this a coat that barely fit. And so they said, okay, the next day, I think, well, even before I got my uniform, they said, I think I was to go down the next day. That was it. I was still in civilian clothes, ordinary street shoes. And they said, come here. And I said, he said, I want you to clean out this latrine. Here's a hose. You just hose it all out. So I'm in there, roll up my suit. I was in a suit. I roll it up. My shoes got wet. It was just a mess. So the next day, as I said, when we went down, I finally got a uniform, and just said what it was. Well, and then they said, okay, you're going to be shipped out to basic training, Jefferson Barracks in St. Louis, Missouri. And you'll receive training there, and then when you're through with basic training, you'll be assigned. Oh, by the way, when I went into the Air Force, and they were asking me if I wanted to fly and so forth, and I said, no, I don't want to fly. And they said, well, what do you want to join the Air Corps for? And I said, because I don't want to carry a gun. So then getting back to when I moved to Jefferson Barracks in St. Louis, it was cold, absolutely freezing. And I was so cold in this darn uniform, of course, you had to pack up your civilian clothes and carry them in a duffel bag, I think they gave us, if I remember correctly. So I get down there, and the first thing I find is that there's a big, there were many barracks, but they had to turn a lot of them into help the base hospital, because there was so many people with pneumonia and stuff, and some of them were dying. So I was assigned to this barracks, and they said, you'll start in the morning with basic training. Now the snow is about a foot deep down there. So we fall out in this ugly uniform, and I was 20 years old, and this guy came out, he must have been close to 30, I guess, what I thought was old, the drill sergeant. So he comes out and gives us a few commands, do this, do that, and oh, we were freezing to death. He put us at ease, goes back in the barracks. And about 2 or 3 minutes later, he comes out, starts, gives us a couple of more commands, at ease, goes back in the barracks. Well, he did that about 3 or 4 times. What he was doing is taking a shot every time he went in there. And he finally came out, couldn't even stand up, so he dismissed us. So, well, that went on for 2 days. And then I had, they sent me down to the mess hall to peel potatoes, and they set me on a chair beside a pile of potatoes that was at least 7 or 8 feet high, and this, and says, start in. So I did, and I thought, no, this is not for me, something's wrong. Well, that went on for about 3 or 4 days or 5 days, and the next thing I know, they come in and said, here's the list of fellows that are being transferred. They're being put up the sign, and I looked at my name's on there. And I said something to the guy, the sergeant, or I guess he was a sergeant at that time. You know, I haven't had any basic training. Oh, he said, you get that to your next station. Well, where they sent me was Langley Field, Virginia, permanent barracks, sun shining, beautiful, gorgeous. And I got in there and I thought, oh, and each squadron had their own kitchen and within the barracks, and you got up, calisthenics, you went and had breakfast and come back, then you were supposed to do, I don't know what, I told them I wanted to be on the line, because I always wanted to fool around with mechanics. Well, so okay, they sent me down to the line.
What was the line?
That's down on the where the airplanes are, and you're supposed to be repairing the airplane. Well, naturally, I don't know anything about an airplane engine, but so what they do with these guys that go down there, all we did was wash engine parts I forget what it is. They won't even allow anybody to use it now. So then all of a sudden, I'm transferred to a new outfit called the 34th Bomb Group. And I was in the 7th Bomb Squadron. And who was our squadron commander but Curtis E. LeMay, captain. And we fell out one Saturday morning, and there's about 5 of us guys that had these World War uniforms on. And so we fell out. I didn't even know how to march. I didn't know how to do anything. And so we're in formation there, and he looked at us guys. He said, where'd you come from? And I said, well, I came from the reception center in Fort Sally, Minnesota. Where'd you get that uniform? I said, it was issued to me. And he did that with all the guys. And he finally said, who's the supply sergeant of this squadron? And some older guy comes out, no stripes, nothing. He says, sergeant, where's your stripes? He said, I just got busted. Well, what they did is they transferred a bunch of screw-ups into this new outfit, because that's what they used to do, is when they were beginning to then expand even before the war was on, before December in 41, and expanding new groups. Well, he said, the guy, fella, he says, you take these people down to Quartermaster Corps and get them outfitted with new outfits, and if you don't do it, I'll do it. So they sent us down, and now I got a brand new uniform, new shoes, cap, a coat that fit, and I thought, well, this is looking better. And so we formed the 34th Bomb Group, and we were there in Langley Field for, oh, I guess maybe 3 or 4 weeks. And then the whole group then moved to Westover Field, Massachusetts, which was colder yet. But it was a dry cold, so you didn't mind it so much. And it, we got to a brand new barracks. There's no sidewalks, no nothing. I mean, it was just built. And of course, we were happy with, you know, it wasn't as good as where we left, but at least it was inside and pretty well organized, you know. And so we were there for a while, and I think that's where Curtis LeMay left us as the squadron went somewhere else. I'm not quite sure. But then we were transferred from there to, I think it was Pendleton Field, Oregon, which was a brand new base. They had no sidewalks, mud and everything else, you know. And we were in a squadron, and I was assigned in Langley Field in this group to the supply, squadron supply. And I wound up with this guy that's supposed to be the sergeant, you know. And all of a sudden I get into, I don't know whether it was in Westover Field. I think it was. Now I'm only in there from probably, went in 20th of December, I think, as I said, and got to Westover Field sometime in the latter part of January. And all of a sudden, and of course you had a officer who was the squadron supply officer, and all of a sudden I go there and this guy is gone. So they had transferred him into somewhere else, got rid of him. And he looked at me and he said, "We're gonna run this. I'm just a buck private, I don't, and not nothing." And so I said, "Well, I don't know that much about it," but he said, "Don't have to, you can type and all that stuff." And, well, back up a bit, I guess I should say. I got tired of this line business, you know. And as I was coming back to the barracks, an officer stopped me and said, "What do you do?" And I said, "Well, I'm supposed to be down on the line." He said, "Do you like it?" And I said, "Well, not particularly." He said, "Do you want an easy job?" He said, "No guard duty, no KP or nothing." He said, "Can you type?" And I said, "Yeah, I can type. Come with me." He says, "You're going to be in supply." Because they couldn't get anybody really to be in the clerical end of the organization, because everybody wanted to be on airplanes and flying and so forth. And so I said, so that's when I got into this deal. And then all of a sudden,
By the way, did you ever go through basic training?
Never. I couldn't march. I couldn't even, when we had formations, I'd always try and get in the back, and everybody, you know, would be like this, and I was relaxed, and as soon as the officer had come down the row, well, I'd do this in a minute. And of course, in Langley Field, it was pretty warm. Some of them passed out, you know, because of, and so I said, they can't tell from where I am whether I'm at attention or what. So as soon as they come down the road, you know, and so I got by the best I could. But then all of a sudden I didn't have to do any of that because I was in the supply end of it. So there was another fellow in another squadron that was an excellent, he'd been in service for about, I think he was on his second hitch. And he was their supply sergeant and was a smart guy. And I went down and talked to him. I said, "Don't worry," he said, "I'll teach you everything you need to know." So I worked with him, and I went from a buck private to a master sergeant in 18 months. And I had every break in the world in the service from a standpoint of doing things.
Did you like working in the supply department?
Yes, I did, because it, it was in that part of time prior to December 7, 1941, you had to count for everything. So you had to make sure if somebody come in and wanted a new shirt, you had an old shirt to turn in. And so, you know, you got organized, and of course, that went on. And then when we moved to Pendleton Field, I think it was because the problem was that the supply business, in supply, you didn't have anything to do from the time you hit the base and got set up till you left, because it was just do things, but you were always the last one to finish working because you had to pack everything. Well, I got out, I think it was Pendleton Field, Oregon. We had moved twice. And so we had a carpenter shop in the organization. And so I said to the lieutenant, I said, you know, this packing and unpacking is for the birds. And he said, what do you think about it? And I said, I'm going down to the carpenter shop and see if they'll make me some boxes that I can pack in, put covers on when we're ready to go, and move them out. When we come back, all we got to do is set them up, take the covers off, and we got it. That was a good idea. So that's what I did. I remember that Sunday, bunch of three or four of us fellows, you could dress in civilian clothes at that time. If you went off the base, you could be in civilian clothes. So we all were dressed up and we decided we were going to see a movie. So we went to the movie, and when we come out, a lot of people were around and there was a big commotion. They said, are you from the base? And we said, yes. Well, you're supposed to get out there right away, that Pearl Harbor is been bombed. And that's when we heard about it. So then when we got back to the base.
You know, by the way, were you surprised? What was your reaction to
not
it?
Really. We were surprised of the raid on Pearl Harbor, but we knew eventually we'd be involved in Europe, not the Pacific, because nobody really had any idea about that. But the other thing too is when I was in Langley Field, got there and was there, I think we were there for about 2 or 3 months maybe. Maybe I didn't stay leave as early as I thought. But we were told that we were in for the duration. No, none of this business being out in 3 years. So then we knew that something was happening. Mm-hmm. So we were surprised it was Pearl Harbor, really.
So what happened as far as to you after that? Did the whole situation change?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. We went back to the base. You weren't allowed to wear civilian clothes anymore. Had to be dressed in uniform all the time. You had to have the proper identification to get back on the base. I remember we had a big, tall, lanky guy from Maine was in our outfit, and he was one of these northeastern guys that was in a small town, hadn't ever been anywhere since, and he was. When I can remember, we stood in line one time for shots. Oh, I got to get ahead of myself a little bit. In Fort Snelling, they give me all the shots that they're supposed to have, you know. And they said, you just take this one time, you can't take it anymore. So when I got to Jefferson Barracks, they said, we can't find your papers. And so you're going to have to go through. And I said, I've had my shots. We have no record of it. So I had them again. And but anyhow, I can remember him standing. He was standing in line in front of me, and he was scared to death of those needles and everything else. And they hit him, and he went flop, just passed out. And they got him up. Well, when we were, as I said, that went the movie and came out, well, then we went right back to the base. Well, when we went to back the base, we had to have proper identification because they said, didn't, if you weren't in uniform, you weren't here.
At this point, there's no fooling around.
No fooling, no. It was serious, and we weren't prepared. I tell you, we weren't prepared. And so he came back to base, and he had a hard time finding his identification. And they told him, you can't come in. He said, okay, I'm going home. And they finally kept him in when he came in, and I said, what do you mean you're going home? He said, I'm going to put up with this stuff. I said, you're in for good. Well, for some reason, the outfit kind of changed a bit with people But that's when it started, and it was. And of course, then there was no accountability, for anything.
What do you mean by that?
In the supply area, there was no accountability. You didn't have to count for this. You just, if you needed something, you went down and got it. And then, as when we left there and went to Pendleton Field, we were a training group, is what we were. And we went, I crisscrossed the states two or three times on the troop trains, and we went out to Pendleton Field, and then we went, as I say, that's when we started, and then we went to Tucson, and were there for a while.
Now, how did you eventually link up with the 390th?
Well, the 34th Bomb Group, we were at Geiger. We were at Pendleton Field and went to Tucson, that was it. And then we went to Geiger Field in Spokane, Washington. And it was cold and foggy, and the airbase was out where you couldn't even fly. And so our group commander was a son-in-law of the general that headed up, I think, the West Coast pretty much division or whatever it was. And he complained to him, so he sent us to Ephrata. And that was worse yet. He complained again, and then they shipped us to Blythe, California, which was a disaster. Anyhow, in Blythe, they were forming a new group. We heard the new group because a bunch of Air Corps people that were in Hawaii, I think it was the 16th Bomb Group or something, or I don't know what it was, over in Hawaii. It was through Pearl Harbor, and they sent some of them back to take over our 34th Bomb Group as a because we were a training group. And a good friend of mine was an engineering officer for the squadron. And he says, you know, they're going, well, I should back up. In when I went in, went to Geiger Field, I took a test to become a warrant officer. As I could, I didn't. I had an opportunity. I applied to go to OCS in, I think it was Westover Field or Pendleton Field, one of them. And a friend of mine took the exam. I passed it. He didn't. So they were going to send me to a quartermaster, OCS. And I got to thinking, if I wash out of this, they're probably going to send me to the infantry. They probably won't send me back. So I decided, no, I don't think I want that. I'm going to stay. I was a master sergeant at that time, or staff sergeant, I think, probably at the most. So when we went to, Ephrata, I was a warrant officer. And then when we got to Blythe, California, this friend of mine who was the engineering officer said, you know, they're forming a new group, training group, is eventually going overseas, and we're going to go anyhow. And he said, you know, I don't really think too much of this new group to come in and take control of it. So he said, let's volunteer for the new thing. Well, I got married in December of 42 in Geiger, and of course then down and went from there to Ephrata and then to Blythe. And he said, let's join this group. He said, it's a brand new group, which was a 390th Bomb Group. So I said, okay, sounds good to me. So he and I volunteered. Bill Pennybaker was in the 34th Bomb Group also. He volunteered. And some other few, there were a lot of them that I didn't know that were in the flying, you know. And so I volunteered, went into 34th, or in the 390th, got into group, and I was the group supply officer. I then worked with all the squadron supply officers. And so then my wife joined me. We were going to be there for a couple months, I guess. And then she joined me in Blythe. And after she got down there, I was there, oh, less than a month. They said, okay, you're going to take this cadre group, and you're going to go to Orlando, Florida for training. Well, then they shipped me out. So she went back to Spokane. We spent, I think, about a month almost in Orlando. I don't know just exactly the time. And then from Orlando, we all went up to Geiger Field, and that's where a lot of the other fellows joined. We knew we were going overseas. And then we went from Geiger, we spread out and went to Montana. Headquarters went to Great Falls, Montana, and then the four squadrons went to Cut Bank, Glasgow, and I can't think of the other. So we were headquartered in Great Falls, and then they were training out on these satellite bases in Montana. And then in July is when we all got together and went to Camp Shanks, New York. That's where we debarked from. And
was it hard to say goodbye to your wife?
Yes, it was.
You know, and I should say, where did you two meet?
Well, I met her when I was there the first time, of course, in Geiger Field. And we knew each other for about 6 weeks, and we knew that was the right thing. We got married, you know.
That fast?
Yeah, her folks said fine. Because I used to go out, she'd invite me out for dinner on Sunday once in a while. I and my buddy, they did, and so then I'd go out, and sometimes in the evening we'd go somewhere, you know, and she had a car, so her folks had a car, so she could drive, and so her dad was a rate clerk for a trucking firm there in Spokane, and he had to work late because of getting the trucks ready to go, and so he always had dinner eight or about around 8:30, and I'd go out there, and her mother would say, "Ken, did you have anything to eat tonight?" "No, I didn't." "Well, sit down and eat with Dad." So I got to the point where I'd go out and have dinner with him, then we'd go out on a date, and so we just decided it was it, and so we got married. And
had you talked about the fact that you were going overseas, and it was a war zone?
Yeah, we did, and it didn't make any difference, because in those days, you weren't probably as conservative as you might be now. And we just said, that's it. What happens, happens. And my friend that we Lieutenant Engler was lieutenant at that time. He said, "We're going overseas. We're going to be over there at least 2 years." And I said, "Oh, that won't be it." Well, we were there 2.5 years. So when I came home, I had a 2 year. Well, Jean was pregnant when I left, and so when I came back, I had a son that was about 2 years old.
Well, when talk about the trip over to Europe.
Oh. Well, we debarked there at Camp Shanks. We went over on what James Parker was the boat, and it was a smaller boat, but there were a lot of protection, you know, some protection. But we took, I forget how many days to get over there, but we. The trip over was different. A lot of guys got sick, you know, seasick. Fortunately, I didn't. I never will forget that we had a, there were four of us people up in what was the brig normally. It was up clear above. And they would always usually announce when they were going to fire the guns, test the guns on the ship, you know. And there was one fellow with us that had just gotten back from Pearl Harbor. He had been through that. And he was sleeping on the upper bunk and didn't hear, like the rest of us did, about the shooting. And he heard that sound, and he come off of that thing like you couldn't believe, and he was just shaking. We landed in Liverpool. And then we took the train from the cruise and everything, flew over there, of course. But we landed in Liverpool, went from Liverpool to Parham, and got on the base, and the base was practically brand new. The 95th Bomb Group had been in there before us for a very short time. They were still working on the base when we got there.
Once you got yourself established on the base, let me talk a little bit about the job you did there. Give me a sort of a job description of what you did there on the base.
Well, all the headquarters was off in one big Nissen complex, huts. And I worked, my job with the group was to work with the English representative, he was called the Clerk of the Works, that whenever you wanted to change anything on the base, they'd change anything you wanted, but you had to go through him to get it done. And then there was, I was in with a captain that was with the station complement group that was worked with, I don't know just what they kind of run the base, but if they had to deal with the British, then I did that. And I worked with him, and he was just a wonderful guy to work with.
I was gonna say, what was the relationship like? Because you did come from two different cultures.
Oh, he was fine. I don't know. We just kind of hit it off because I, you don't get anything unless you work with the person. And you got to kind of feel him out. And I found out that, you know, to find out his background and what he's doing, the same with me. And we just kind of got along. And then during a period of shortly after we got there, the ground exec called myself and this captain from the complement group in his office and said, we got a job for you guys you're going to have to do. And we said, what's that? And they said, we're going to send you down to the GI mess hall and clean it up. It's a real mess. And he said, we're going to send a lieutenant with you that you can do what you want with him. He came over in a crew and refused to fly. So he said, do what you want. So we went out. So we were cleaned up the mess hall. We cleaned it all up, and we had to go back periodically, take turns, and when they were getting breakfast and meals and so forth, make sure everything is going right. Well, I had access to a little extra food and stuff, and this clerk of the works, I said to him one day, I said, how do you get your butter and eggs? Well, we don't get any at all. And I said, well, would you like some? So I would get him a pound of butter and a dozen eggs and take to him, and that was, you know, he got everything.
A friend for life.
That's right. I remember there were five of us guys, I think it was, the engineering officer, armament officer, communication officer, quartermaster officer, and myself. There were six of us in this big room. It was about this big. You had your cots along there, and you had a wash basin in the, no, you didn't have any you had to go down the hall to the shower or bathroom. Well, they didn't have showers, they had bathtubs and the sinks. Well, my gosh, there was a whole bunch of officers in there. And so I decided, and we were all griping about it took so long to get down there to get a sink. So I talked to this clerk of the works, and of course we had a pretty big room. It had a potbelly stove at the end of it. And I said, is there any chance that you can put a sink in this room? And well, he said, yeah. He said, of course, all the pipes, regardless of cold, were above ground, but they'd insulate them, I guess. But because, well, anyhow, he said, yeah, I can do that. So he put a sink in, and so we had that. Well, next door to us were two officers. They were majors. And they came in one day, and they said, where'd you get that? And I said, well, I said, we had to have it because we got so many people in here. Well, they wanted to get one. And so they were not very popular guys anyhow. And so I told the, I can't even think of his name now, looked where I said, if they want you to come, tell them, no, you can't do it. Well, they asked him, and he said, no, I can't take care of it. But anyhow, we got that taken care of, and then the armament officer. They, when we went over there, you didn't have chin turrets on the airplane.
So this was the F model.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And you didn't have turrets at the top, I think it was. And so they shipped these turrets in beautiful inch plywood. Absolutely perfect. And so our armament officer says, he and the engineering officer were pretty inventive in doing things. And so Norm Sell was his name. He said, you know, we're going to take that plywood and we're going to build us lockers around the room. And we arranged things. So we each had, well, two of us had the locker that was about so big, beautiful thing, setting up against the wall. So we had a lot of things that a lot of the other ones didn't have because just of the guys that we had together.
How much control over your situation did you have? Did you have someone just watching your every move, or did you have a fair amount of independence?
Oh, I had all the independence I needed, always did have. In the all time I was in the service.
Did you, was it a job that was, you know, Monday through Friday, 9 to 5? I mean,
it was a job 7 days a week, 24 hours a day.
So you could, it was that demanding? I mean, you just had to be ready to go at any time?
Yeah, one of the jobs that I inherited was we were one of the closest bases to the English Channel. And when the British bombed at night, we bombed during the day. And when they came home, the cripples and so forth always landed at our base. And of course, they would, the ground exec would call me and say, you get some guys and set up, because we had an area where we set up for them. And because they're coming in around 2, 3, 4 o'clock. So we have to work to that point and make sure that they got there and had a place to sleep and had blankets and everything else.
Did the base ever come under attack while you were there?
No, the only one we had, I was talking with somebody today, the only one we had was some personnel bombs were dropped, but there was no damage done. Other than that, no.
Did you ever see the V-1 rockets going over?
Well, when we'd go to London, when we, the first V1, you could always hear it. And when the engine stopped, you knew that it was going to drop and explode. And of course, you could hear them going over, you know, because we were on the path to London, really. And, but when the V2s, you couldn't hear them till they exploded. And the only time you got into that kind of problem was when you go to London. Going to London on a leave, why, you'd hear all of this bomb going off and everything. He just hoped that they missed the the hotel.
Did you see some of the V1s, V2s?
Oh yeah. They always came over at night, and you could always follow a trail with them. Now the V2 was not as obvious as the V1 was, because you could see the V1 and watch it go.
Picking up on that, so there were times you got a pass and you were able to get into London?
Yeah, you see the flight crews always got a pass ever so many days, I guess it was, and we could go in basically whenever we wanted to.
And what was wartime London like? I mean, you've described the rockets, that kind of thing, but was it obvious that a war was going on?
Oh, sure. It was dark as could be, and the taxi cabs only had little slits in the lights. You couldn't even see them, and like the British used to call us crazy Yanks, because when they started those V2s or any bombing, we were always out there watching. Get in the shelters, get in. And the other thing is that when you took the train into London, and they had a tube system that was fantastic. You could go anywhere. Well, down in those tubes sometimes went down 3 and 4 deep, you know, way down.
Like a stories deep.
Yeah. And there was any number of people that were in these tubes. That's where their shelter was. And some of them were bombed out and they just lived in there.
What would you do when you go into London? I mean,
well, we used to go to a lot of shows. They had a lot of good musicals and things, stage shows. And we go, and the funny thing was, we'd be laughing our heads off, and the British wouldn't even say anything. And when they were laughing, we said, "What's so funny?" But it was, that's all we did. This was a time to go in and.
Were you able to stay in touch with your wife?
Oh, yes. I'd write her a V-mail every day, and she wrote me a letter every day. And you'd get maybe 3 or 4 letters at one time, and maybe she'd get 3 or 4 emails at one time. And, of course, I could do my own censoring, so nobody... You used to have to censor some of the enlisted men's mail, but the officers did their own.
Do you remember getting the letter from her that your son had been that?
Oh yeah,
your son
yeah.
Had been born?
She'd keep telling me that. Well, it's getting closer, and then finally, she sent me a letter that he had been born on. I think it was October 9th, and then she sent me pictures all the time, and so I was watching him grow. Hmm.
You know, when you think back of those 2.5 years on the base there at Framlingham, what kinds of things pop into your mind? What were there unusual things that happened, mishaps, things that you remember about your experience there?
Oh, I don't know. It was, we had it very easy. You know, the heroes of the organization were the flyboys, and I used to. Of course, I knew a lot of the flight crews and the original group that we went over with, but the turnover was so great. We used to play poker at night with guys, and we'd sit down, and the next day they'd be gone. Mm-hmm. So you never knew. And you get acquainted with somebody, and you know, I knew a lot of the officers that were lost.
How did people you know handle that kind of... I mean, really astonishing loss. I mean, these young men are there, and you're playing poker, and then they're not there anymore. How do you mentally handle that?
Well, the thing is that I think you condition yourself to even the. I have a lot of friends now. All the people I work with now, board and so forth, most of them were flight people. I never knew them overseas, but talking with them, they just said, you know, they knew the problem, but they just did it. And I said, I could not do that. I just couldn't. And he said, well, you would do it. You just get up there and you know the risk you're taking, and that's it.
Did your job evolve in some ways over that 2.5 years? In other words, did it? You went over there when you first started. You were doing certain things. Did it kind of modify and change as you went along?
Well, you see, we didn't have to count for anything. And when the war was over with, coming home, prior to coming home, a bunch of new people came in to take our place. And I remember one of the supply people that I had to deal with. The first question they asked me, they said, how do you account for your airplanes that you lost? I said, what do you mean account for them? Well, didn't you account for them? I said, no. I said, there was no way you could account for them. Oh, yes, you can do this. Do you know how many are lost? I said, close to it, but I said, I don't have any. Well, why didn't you do that? And I said, sir, if you want to do it, you be my guest. But we didn't have time to worry about that. It was keeping those airplanes in line, working. Now, the engineering officer, armament officer, and communication officer sometimes would work through the clock, especially the group engineering officer, because they had to repair the planes. And when they come in, shot up, they had to get them ready to fly the next day if they could. So they'd work all night.
Did you ever run out of things, supplies and?
No.
No, you were that well supplied.
Yeah.
Wow. Talk about some of the problems you had on the job, things you had to solve and work out, because it was a whole new thing.
Well, having been in over a year before the war started, you knew what to do and how to get things. We had no problem. There was a base supply officer and people, and there were also Air Corps people that were worked with the air, like jackets and parachutes, and they had a separate outfit that did all the parachute packing and all that. And so they had more problems getting parts and stuff than we had anything else. I mean, we could get anything we wanted.
You know, at some point the war was over, there was VE Day. Was it champagne and hurrahs? I mean, what was your experience? What happened?
Well, we all expected it to come, so we were just waiting for it. But all we did is just wind down. The flight crews left.
And there was no big party or anything like that?
No. Well, we had a 100 mission party, 200 mission party, and a 300 mission party. Now, that was different because a bunch of nurses came in, our British girls came in, and the officers had an area, and the enlisted men had a hangar, and the 300 mission party was really the big one. And our armament officer had a lot of talent, and so he went around and got all the colored parachutes that he could get. And they decorated the hangar with these yellow, blue, so forth, parachutes. And we had Glenn Miller there. Glenn Miller appeared for probably 20 minutes, and he was gone, and Tex Beneke took over. Of course, just shortly after that, he was lost in the English Channel or somewheres. But we had a wonderful time. I mean, it was just of course, you always had all the liquor you could handle.
You know, one question that just occurred to me, the war is over and all that. Had you had an opportunity to actually fly in a B-17 at any point?
No, I tell you, the only time I flew in an Army aircraft was when I was in Langley Field. We had B-18s, and I got courage enough to ride, go for a ride in it, of course. So it was just bare nothing, you know. And they says, you go down and get a parachute. So I went down and got a parachute, and I said, what do I do with this? And so he showed me what you're supposed to do, and I thought, I hope I don't have to use it. And that was the only time. I've been through many of them, you know. And I used to go down on the line with the engineering officer and watch what they were doing and looking around, you know. So I was pretty much savvy of what went on with the flying and the guys that did the flying, you know. We left, I forget how much time after the air crews left, but they just packed us up. You just took what you had. You left the base as it was. You didn't have to move anything. You just packed your, you had I think they call them A4 bag or something. I don't know what it was. You put all your stuff in it. They took you on train up to the Liverpool and got on a boat. We came back on the Queen Elizabeth, I think. And we beat the Queen Mary's fastest time coming back. With just a little short of 4 days coming back.
What was it like on the ship? Was it crowded?
Oh, it was wonderful.
Was it crowded?
Oh yeah, it was crowded.
Why did he say it was wonderful?
Well, you were going home. You were going home and looking forward to seeing your family again. I hadn't seen them, we landed in, went through, I think, Camp Shanks again, and then we train out to the West Coast, and I had to go to Fort Lewis, and so went there and got a leave. Went to Spokane. We had a month's leave, and we were supposed to go to back to Sioux Falls, South Dakota, and join and be a B-29 group and go to the Pacific.
Well, somewhere in there, where did you link up with your wife? Because that's been 2.5 years. You've got a son.
Well, here's what happened. When I called her from Fort Lewis, I called her from New York, and I called her from the Fort Lewis, and I said, I'll be home. I've got to go through the center here to get cleared to take my leave. And I said, I'll be there. Well, shoot, you take the train from Fort Lewis to Spokane. It wasn't long. And so I told him when I called and I said, well, I'm leaving. And so when we arrived, I just barely got out of the train, and I could see her running toward me, and you know, and then because her mother had the little one, and of course when I got home, and my wife was working all the time I was gone, saving money, and I was sending money home, so we had a pretty good little nest egg when we come back to buy a house. Well, anyhow, her mother took care of Rick, our son. And he was spoiled. Oh, he was spoiled. And he didn't want anything to do with either one of us, really. But he did, her mother handed him to me, and he was quite, you know, of course, like Gene said, that's all we talked about was his daddy was overseas and showed pictures, you know, and things. So it was quite a thing. Really, it was, and then when I was home, VJ Day came along, and they said if you had so many points, you could get out. Well, because every time the air crews got medals and stuff, we all got them, and I had 100-some-odd points, and so you only needed, I don't know what it was. So when I had report back to Fort Lewis, And the first thing I asked when I got in there, I said, I can get out of this thing. And how many points you got? And they, oh, yeah, you can. So we'll transfer you to another area, and you got to go through 2 days of conditioning to become a civilian. I said, I don't need any time to become a civilian. So I spent that time and came back, and they tried to talk me in joining the reserves. And you do this, and I said, you know, I volunteered for 3 and I got 5, a little over 5 years, and I said, I'm not interested in doing anything anymore. I'm out of here. I started business school, college in Spokane. They had an excellent accounting area, and I decided one time, I said to my wife, I said, what's a CPA? And she told me, I said, that sounds good, I'm going to try it. So I started to school, still working at this furniture place. I go at night school, and I went 3 nights a week, and I studied 2 nights a week. I took the weekend off if I could. And finally, after I think I was through about 2 semesters of the accounting and auditing and that stuff, one of the teachers, well, there was an accounting firm, the largest in a small hometown accounting firm there in Spokane, run this school. And one of the teachers was from the accounting office. And so one day he asked me, he said, are you interested? I was telling him what I was doing. He said, are you interested in going to work for us? And I said, yeah, I think I would be. And he said, all right, come on down. And he said, we'll start you out from the bottom. And the crux of the whole thing is that I started to work there and worked for a few years and moved to Seattle, to California, retired in California, and came up and moved to...
So did you work as a CPA?
No, I went to work for this firm and spent 3 years, I think, almost with them. And I decided that Spokane didn't have what I wanted, so I went over to Seattle and called on, it was a national firm known as Ernst & Ernst at that time. It's now Ernst & something else. And so they said, well, yeah, we'll hire you. But it was a temporary, supposedly through tax season and audit season. Well, I was fortunate enough to stay through the summer, almost 3 years, and I finally said, you know, I don't think public accounting is for me because I'm more interested in getting into a business. And so they said, fine, we'll find a job for you. So they put me in with one of their clients, which was in construction. So I spent the rest of my career in a controller for a construction firm, and then I retired.
You know, at the age you are now, when you look back at the 390th and your experience, are you proud of that time?
Absolutely.
But why is that?
There was such a camaraderie of people that you got to know. We all knew we had a job to do. We wanted to get it over with. The people were behind us, and so we just said, fine, let's do it. And when we got out, everybody was ready to go to work. The GI Bill came along, which was a wonderful thing. We could go to school, which I did on the GI Bill. And you got a career and you got started working. You didn't worry whether the government was going to take care of you.
Did you, when you got home after that 2.5 years, did you feel like you were a little different? I mean, you were either grown up or I mean, did you?
Well, I grew up during the service, really. It was a great time. I don't know what it is now, but I would think that young people should spend some time in the service because it's discipline and you have to do something. When I was working, I didn't have much time to think about anything but work. When I retired, I said, I want to play golf and enjoy myself. And I've done that. And I've always been of the opinion, what happens, happens. You do the best you can. And I used to tell my son when he was growing up and started to, in high school and got his job, I said, I don't care what you do, but if you do it well, I'll be proud of you.